Oh, that's a mellow sound. In keeping with a moody city called New Orleans, which our guest offstage will describe in brief. Throughout the year, I invite you to go with me as I make the rounds of festivals, concerts, clubs, and cabarets in search of the jazz life. This is Leigh Kamman. Once again, I'll take you to New Orleans in search of the jazz life, but in this case, jazz life and education come together. The personality is deeply involved with both. So it's off stage to the 28th New Orleans Heritage and Jazz Festival. It's May 3rd, 1997. And it's all a part of the 1997 jazz residency provided by Northwest Airlines.
Germaine Bazzle, welcome to Minnesota Public Radio.
Why, thank you very much. This is a pleasure for me.
You're warming us up, you know, in our sub-zero climes in the land of lakes and ice.
Yes, I am aware of that. And I'm so glad that you're here where we have a little sunshine anyway, you know.
The pores are opening.
Yeah.
For those north of the Mason-Dixon and north of the Crescent City, you might describe your role in the musical arts of New Orleans.
Well, I guess I need to say to you that first of all, I'm a music teacher, okay? And I'm working in an all-girl high school. And the other side of the coin is that other than being a performer with these guys here at Jazz Fest, I do some choral singing also. So I'm very much involved in the whole music system, if you will, here in New Orleans.
And I imagine you're seeing students growing up under your wing and developing.
Yes, I am. In fact, the young lady who was just standing near me a little while ago is one of my former students, and I just felt very good when she told me she's still playing the cello. You know, I don't want her to give that up because I know what the advantages are of being able to, you know, be involved in the arts other than your daily work.
And some of your daily work involves the atmosphere and the mood of the night and the moods of the night and New Orleans.
Yes, it does. It does. And New Orleans is a very moody city, if you know what I mean. So, but I'm involved in all of it. And if you listen very well, you hear all of it in my performance, you know.
For you, where did it begin?
I guess as a child, you know, growing up in a home where there was music all of the time. My mom and daddy played piano, grandparents played music. I just grew up in that kind of environment. And I guess I started taking formal music lessons around 12 years old, you know, way back then. And I have just continued on since then. I think that music is something that I had to do. I don't have any choice about it.
How do you describe the muse inside of you?
He just takes charge. He's very demanding. He's very demanding. He often says to me, you go out and you do this. And he finds work for me. I don't call for the jobs. He finds work for me. He guides me through the musicians. He's always ever present.
Those music materials you perform seem, as I listen to you, to run the gamut from the world of opera to jazz and the tones of the blues.
All of it's involved. All of it's involved. Having had some formal voice training, you know, there are things that you're taught. In the university, having participated in the operas, you know, that kind of thing. Having performed or played bass in the symphonic band. Having sung, it's all there. I don't deny any of it, and I'm just so glad that it's all there and it comes out as it pleases.
May I just pose three or four names and get an off the top of the head reaction? In the world of jazz, the messengers, I'll start with Billie Holiday. What do you say?
what is there to say? Billie Holiday said it all. The pathos in her voice, in her music, was so, how do I say, powerful. So powerful that when one listens, it's not so much that, well, when I listen, it's not so much that I'm listening for intonation or anything like that. I'm just listening for her soul. And it just, I don't know what else to say.
Sarah Vaughan.
Oh, my Lord, that's a great influence, you know? When I started doing this, I was doing the same thing that young people are doing now, sitting by the radio, listening to Sarah Vaughan, trying to imitate Sarah Vaughan, getting as many Sarah Vaughan licks as I possibly could. She was the singer who proved to me that for my own particular voice, the contralto that I am, that it was possible for me to do what I'm doing and not necessarily do a lot of yelling and screaming and that kind of thing. I could go on and use my voice training. Yeah.
Ella Fitzgerald.
I have no words. I have no words. Ella has been for me a mentor, if you will. I've never met her, but every time I hear her, it's like she's teaching something to me. I was very much influenced by her very first recording my dad brought home, which was a Tisket a Tasket. You know, and my dad sort of set her up as, you should listen to her, you listen to her, you know, she's a little girl where she's doing this, and they kept Ella Fitzgerald recordings in the home, so you sort of, you know, I sort of grew up with her, you know, so that's there too, that's that influence also.
I want to thank you for taking time to talk with us
at
Minnesota Public Radio. What a pleasure to meet you.
Thank you very much, it's my pleasure.
It is a May Day, third day of this weekend, and we're at the Louisiana, New Orleans, Crescent City Heritage and Jazz Festival. I've been talking with Germaine Bazzle.
Thank you so very much. I enjoyed it. And folks in Minneapolis, St. Paul, hang in there. Have a good time.
Thank you.